Officially, welcome to a regular membership meeting of the San Geronimo Valley Planning Group. We pride ourselves in being one of the oldest West Marin environmental organizations, the oldest valley organization. We were founded in 1972. We've been working very hard to not only protect our immediate community, but the larger environment. All of our steering community members have been involved in local environmental issues for a very long time. And 80 participants, which is, that's great. I would like to say before I hand it off to Nancy one last time, for those of you who are not speakers tonight, and for those of you who are not members of the steering committee, would you please mute yourself? Rustling of papers or even small sounds can, on Zoom, can interrupt the process. So with that said, and a big thank you to all the people participating, I'm going to hand it off to Nancy Binson. Nancy.
Thank you, Brian. So once again, I also want to echo Brian's thanks to all of you who are on this call, the Zoom meeting tonight. We really appreciate you being here. And a special thank you to the council members. For those of you who got into the room a little bit late, I just want to say that you'll be hearing from each of them and they will introduce themselves. But if you are looking at their IDs at all, there's Dean and Jason and Steve and Joe and Sky Road, our Coast Miwok Tribal Council members. And we're very grateful to have them with us tonight. Before we start, I just want to begin with a land acknowledgement, which some of you probably now are familiar with it. It's becoming more common these days to open events and meetings with the recognition that we are trespassers. We are the interlopers. We are the latecomers to the places that we now are in. And it's really important to honor those who were the original caretakers and who are still part of this land. So I want to acknowledge that San Geronimo Valley is part of the unceded ancestral lands of the Coast Miwok people of present-day Marin and southern Sonoma counties. We honor with gratitude the land itself and all of its ancestors, past, present, and emerging. We are grateful for the opportunity tonight to learn. Thank you. The Tribal Council who are here tonight, they're all Coast Miwok descendants. They either have California Indian enrollment numbers and or a certification degree of Indian blood called the CDIB for short, and or a certificate of Indian verification that's provided by the United States Department of the Interior. And in addition to that, many of them are lineal descendants of either Tom Smith or Maria Copa. These were two revered Coast Miwok elders who were born in the early to mid 1800s in Marin County. They were interviewed by ethnographer Isabel Kelly in 1931-32. And at that point, Tom was in his 90s and Maria was in her 60s. So there is a long lineage going back, not only how far back they will talk about with their deep roots, but just the people you're looking at tonight, who are in this room tonight, can directly trace back to people who lived here not that long ago, really, not that long ago. So tonight's presentation, as most of you know, will include a brief history of the Coast Miwok in Marin County, as handed down orally through the generations, including some stories that relate specifically to West Marin and the Valley. There will be some history, both pre-colonization and post-colonization. So some very uplifting and some very heart-rending. They will talk a bit about what the council is doing right now. They'll share a vision for the future. We'll hear a few songs in Coast Miwok. And again, I just want to reiterate that, as Brian said, any questions, all of the floor will be open. Put your questions into the chat room box. I'll do my best to track them. And at the end of the presentation by the members of the council, I'll direct questions from the chat to them. And hopefully we'll be able to get all of your curiosity, or at least a lot of it, answered tonight. So at this point, I would like to turn the evening over to the council and let them guide us from here.
Oh, thank you, Nancy.
You're welcome.
And I guess I've been selected to go first. Again, you know, the way I was taught, again, I'm a traditional cultural bear of our roundhouse ways. That's our traditional, I guess you could say, our spiritual practices conduct at those ceremonies and that relationship. And it's a big part of our culture. And it's amazing that we still have that. And I believe in our culture. And I believe it has helped sustain us. So with that said, you know, I'll start off in a good way. We're always taught, you know, whenever we share space with our relatives, the other relatives, that we start off in a good way and we give that blessing. So in my humble way, I will offer that on behalf of all of us. Again, Mamola Obosuki. Thank you. Grateful for this day, Grandfather. Come to you humbly, one of your many servants, and ask for guidance, for blessings. Allow us to hear what it is we need to hear. Allow us to see what it is we need to see. And let us do this with kindness. Let us do it with good intentions, Grandfather. Thankful for our ancestors. We're thankful for those that have come before us, that have left us this beautiful legacy and those traditional teachings. How to be good relatives, how to be good caretakers of all our sacred lands. So again, I say Yahweh for this time and bless each and every one of relatives sharing this space this evening and those that cannot be with us. Just ask for that blessing, that guidance. So Yahweh Kuri Waya. Thank you. And so we, it's our practice whenever you hear us say, oh, and that's like our tradition. And when we hear something, we see something, we feel something from our relatives, we acknowledge them, we affirm them with that oh, that saying, I show you appreciation, you know, for what you shared, for being in this way, you know, and having good intentions. So I, you know, we don't, everything we do has a purpose. It's not, let's just make something up. Let's just do it, you know, on a whim. And this is what, you know, I believe this is what has sustained us, because we're, you know, we've been given these teachings, how to care for ourselves and how to care for one another. And I'm so really enthused. I'm so pleased. I'm so happy. My heart is, you know, just, wow. I can't say it enough, because this is a, you know, this is a part of a vision of that, you know, my ancestors had. We are their prayers. We are the prayers of our ancestors. You know, somebody mentioned, or somebody made a comment about, you know, when they asked about the Miwoks, the Coast Miwoks, and they said, no, they're not here. Joke's on somebody. We've always been here. And we will remain. Because everything we do, and the way we're taught, everything we do in the mind, and with the idea that we do it for our future generations. You know, so it's not about, you know, me and I, but it's about us. So, you know, I just want to share those comments. And as far as, you know, myself being Coast Miwok, man, I'm vetted by the most, it's not a government entity, but it's from my great grandmother, Maria Copa. That's how I am. That's who I get the, you know, authority from, to say, I am Hukukio. I come from that. My people come from that village of Ekatama, at the present day town of Nakasio. And that's why it's exciting, because you all represent, you know, that area that, you know, is close to where my ancestors, our ancestors come from. I just drove by there yesterday on my way to, you know, I went to pray. I went to sing songs, ceremonial songs at our grounds over there at Kulilokolo. You know, I went to give thanks, and it was a beautiful day, and on my way. And then I went out to the ocean to pray at that water, because we believe that our ancestors, that's where they go to. In that western direction, they go back to that water. And so I went to offer prayers and to gather that medicine, you know. So this is who I am. Although I am a part of this, what we call a colonized world, you know, I live in two worlds, you know. And so I just want to share a little bit about, again, who I am, and just I'm thankful for, again, for my cousins, for our other council members. I'll let them introduce themselves, share some things, you know. And so I'm just excited about the time we get to spend, and hopefully you can learn just a little bit, you know. And we do it, again, always with in a respectful manner. Because that's what my grandmother taught me, all my grandmothers. We come from, matriarchal societies, you know. And so I'm thankful. And like I said before, you know, I actually going through this grieving process. I just lost my mother back in February. But I'm thankful for my mother and my grandma and my great-grandmothers. My great-great-grandmothers, because they taught me the most important thing, how to love. That's what's at the foundation of everything we do, that hopefully someday we get to share that with you all in our traditional ways. So again, thank you all. I'll just pass it. I don't know what the order is. So I'll pass it to my fellow council members. Thank you.
Oh,
Dean.
Open to wish, welcome and thank you for attending and thank you for the land acknowledgement. My name is Joe Sanchez and I'm a documented Coast Miwok of Marin County. My family's from Etchikolon Marconi on the east shore of Tomales Bay and from Etchitamal and Ocasio. My great-great-grandmother, Francesca Vanicola, is on the 1870 and 1880 census records for Nicasio. But my family actually goes back much, much farther than that. My great-great-great-great-grandmother is buried in the Marconi graveyard, which they call the Indian Cemetery. She's buried there, and she's full-blooded Coast Miwok. It's really a privilege to speak with you tonight. I see Betty Gerke there. I haven't seen her in a while, but we've met before. It's wonderful to see her again. But in any case, I just want to give you an idea of what it was like for my tribe before the European invasion. If you can imagine walking in a redwood forest, an uncut old growth redwood forest, the size of the trunks, those trees rising over 300 feet up in the air. Can you imagine yourself standing next to that? How small you might feel in this wonderful, incredible environment that's unique in the world. Whenever I'm in Nicasio or Point Reyes and driving through the redwood forest, I always feel such a connection that it's just a wonderful feeling. I've been around the world a couple of times, and believe me, the south of France has nothing on our redwood trees, our redwood forests, and our beautiful land that we have and we appreciate here. I just want you to think of what it must have been like to see this huge mass up in the sky coming toward you. It's a mile wide and 6 miles long. You don't know what it is until it gets right up to you and you realize it's monarch butterflies. A tremendous amount of monarch butterflies. Birds that would obliterate the sun. You wouldn't be able to see the sun for an hour at a time. This was a common thing back in those days. You can imagine what that must have been like, with the rivers and streams overflowing with fish, so easily taken that you could just grab them right out of the water. It's just an incredible, incredible place that we live in. And what I've learned about my people, that we tended the land. We nurtured the land. We made it even more productive by doing certain things, such as controlled burning, which we could learn a lot about now with the wildfires we've had. So there's a lot to learn about the Coast Miwok people and what regard we hold for those things around us, the life that extends to us and allows us to live for thousands of years in harmony with the world, with the atmosphere, with the ecological place that we're in. It's so incredible to me how beautiful it was. It still is. But if you stop and think about what it used to be like, it's quite remarkable. And anyway, I just want to thank you for being a part of this. I feel honored to be here to address you, and I want to thank you very much for that privilege.
Joe.
Can open toys. This is Sky Road Web. I'm a Tomales Bay band descendant, Coast Miwok descendant. Documented, also known as Etchikolom, And my family is documented in mission baptismal records. And my family was also, I had some relatives who were buried at the cemetery in Marshall, and family going back over into Bolinas. And also, family, just we can't hardly talk about the, we can't hardly talk about our roots are here in with the Coast Miwok without also talking about the Mission Indians and that relationship with Mission San Rafael and the mission. And I just want to point out something that came from that. You may have seen these before. These are called the God's Eyes. Sometimes they're a craft that kids do now these days, little God's Eyes. Ojo de Dios. Well, here's actually a more elaborate one. And the Ojo de Dios is a, you know, it starts down in Mexico and brought in through the mission system, and it was brought all the way up in here. And now you see some Miwok families have their house full of God's Eyes now as well. And this is a kind of a symbiosis of the native and that and the Catholicism. These beautiful tapestries are all around us, and sometimes we don't even know where they come from. But you know, just to mention that that connectedness that we have and the diversity of our culture that we come from. But I'd like to just say, offer a little blessing for us. This is one of the things you guys are used to seeing so much here is the abalone shell. That's real common here on the coast. If you're in Marin, then you get used to seeing these. But these are sacred things in Native community, and we use them as a to hold our smudge, our medicine. And also these were traded all the way to natives throughout United States. I've seen old photos out in the New Mexico of a Indian out there wearing a big old abalone shell on his chest. So these are different. Mm-hmm. So sometimes we'll wear abalone as in our dance regalia and for good luck. And so we wear that abalone is a part of our life. So I just wanted to offer as a blessing song for us. And it's a simple little song. It means Hinakapami Awuk Chewa. And so what it means literally is put on the abalone shine. Awuk is abalone and Chewa is the light, the brightness. So put on that abalone shine. And so so I invite you to put on that abalone shine. And if you can, a few of these bars you can sing along with me. It goes up. Hinakapami, Hinakapami. Hinakapami. Let me see if I can do something here. Okay. Hinakapami, 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 Hawukewa. Awukewa, Hinakapami, Awukewa, Hinakapami, 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 Awukewa, 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 Hinakapami, Awukewa. Hinakapami, 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 Hawukewa, 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 Hinakapami, Hawukewa, Hinakapami, 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 Hawukewa. Awukewa, Hinakapami, Awukewa. Oh.
Oh.
And I hope out there, oh, land, all you guys are going, oh.
Oh.
So blessings. Oh. Looking forward to speaking some more with you this evening. A real honor to join you this tonight. Oh.
So thank you, Sky. It really warms my heart when I hear the words spoken of a language that is remarkably still alive at this point. I'm going to talk about the ancestor that I'm descended from, and I'm going to also give you some dates. That's not to be too clinical. That's just to help you understand it. It wasn't that long ago that Marin County was entirely populated by Coast Miwoks. So it's important to understand the world in which she was born in. Her name was Carmel Higuera Comchatal. And so you can imagine the Carmel Higuera probably came from when she was baptized, Spanish. But Comchatal is an interesting word. It's a borrow word, and we've traced it back to Fort Ross when the Russians were up doing their thing up there. And they had a term for natives that had children with Russians in Kamchatka when they were up there. And they call them Comchatal, which basically, just to be blunt, it's like half-breed. However, we feel that the way that this family name was carried on through generations after Fort Ross, that was more of a, it was an honor term. And so, because the family used it. In fact, Tom Smith, who we're descended from, his name is Tom Comchatal. He's, we believe, a brother of Carmel. And he became Tom Smith because it was easier if you had a bland name in those times. You didn't stand out as an Indian. So between 1783 and 1832, the mission systems entirely depopulated all the ancient villages in Marin County. So people will say, well, what village are you from? Well, at that time, the only records of what villages people were from are in the mission records, and we've traced some of our people back to those villages. But it's important to understand that during that period, 1783, 1832, the whole world changed for Coast Miwoks. In fact, it didn't get much better when the Mexican government took over the mission system, the so-called secularization. You can imagine there was all these missions in the Bay Area, including San Rafael, that the mission fathers had promised to turn all the land, all the mission land, cattle, portions of the wealth over to the Indians that had worked on the missions. Well, that's not going to sit well with the Mexican government and the early Californos that were arriving there. And so during this time of secularization, all of the Indians that were at the missions were basically captured by the ranchos. Think of Vallejo over in Petaluma with his adobe. So they were captured in this horrible mission system, and now they're captured into this rancho system. And they were slaves, there's no doubt about that. So Carmel was born in 1840. So she's born into this tumultuous period where there's no rights for Indians. They're less than cattle, treated like, you know, there's plenty of literature out there on how they were treated. And so we actually have census records that shows in 1856, she was with her family in Sonoma making adobe bricks. So that's what she was doing to survive. But in 1860, she married our third great grandfather, Joseph D'Amelia, who was an Italian fisherman, who set up shop there in Tamales Bay. And when you think about an Indian person in 1860, they had no choices, especially the women, because in 1850, when California became a state, and many of you know this, it basically legalized the slavery or the indentured servitude of any Indians in California. So I could say, hey, I've got five Indians living on my ranch, I could go take them and I would own them. So if you can imagine what that means to the women, I won't go into any detail, but one of their many adaptations was to marry, because if they had a man that they were married to that was earning an income, they could produce children, which they did, and they could have a semblance of a life. So the reason I tell you this is because on my side of the family, the fact of our Indian heritage was not provided to me, because there was a lot of shame associated, and I'm talking now about the Tomales Bay, Bodega Bay, Nicasio area, in being an Indian. And my relatives would say they're Mexican, they're Black, they would say anything but being Indian. So that intergenerational shame basically went down through the generations, and I didn't find out about my heritage until 1970, which to me was shocking that, my grandfather never mentioned that to me. And then that's where I came to find out about the shame was so great that they felt, my relatives, that they couldn't bear to admit to this heritage. So through my work on the tribal council, I want to honor them. And I also want to honor all of our relatives, current and future as well.
Oh. Thank you, Steve.
Thank you, Steve. Yes, my name is Jason Deschler. I am a Coast Miwok, descendant of Tom Smith. We come from the most recent village of Etchecolom, which you all know as Tomales Bay, and also Etchetomal, which you know as Nicasio. But to further the village of Nicasio, Nicasio is a main village made up of multiple small villages. And one of those small villages is, where you guys represent right now, the San Geronimo Valley, which we know in our language as Shatako, which means the live oak people. So Shatako was a branch of Etchetomal. So we also claim Shatako as well. To furthermore our lineage, we go all the way into Bodega Bay from Tom Smith, as some of my relatives have mentioned, to his father, Tomas Comchatal. So Tom Smith was a name that was given to him from Captain Smith. Tom Smith had a brother, a half-brother from the captain, Bill Smith, William Smith. Two different lines, but same family. You might know the Smith Fishing Company, the Smith Brothers. That's from William Smith. Tom Smith's mother is Tusupu. Tusupu was the head woman of Petaluma. Petaluma is our language as well, our ancestral village. Tom Smith's father, Tomas Comchatal, we've been doing some researching on this name. When you see it today, it's spelt with a C. And we believe that comes from Spanish influence. The name goes deeper. It's spelt with a K. It's a relationship between the Russians and the fur trading that we had going on along the coast for who knows how long. We believe that we were called the Comchatal people based on being indigenous, the color of our skin being darker. We see this in the relationship that the Russians had with the Kamchatka people from Russia. We believe that there is a similarity there. So I just wanted to point that out, because we tend to believe there's this gap between Drake and the Spanish, but there never was. We were always aware of the outside world. And that's just one point that I wanted to make there. Because you know, our history goes deep when you start talking along those lines. We've been categorized, we've been stereotyped as only being in one area and not knowing of the outside areas or worlds, but we did. There was such a huge difference between us and the Pomo North, especially in language. There's a huge difference. Yet, we still had this knowledge of people farther, farther away. So we weren't an ignorant people. We were very aware of what was going on around the world. And back to what Dean said in the beginning, as cultural, ceremonial people, one thing that we do when we pray in our roundhouse is we pray for the entire world, because we've always been aware of the four directions. And everything in our roundhouse, in our dance homes, is symbolic to the world. We have four poles, four directions, four seasons, four cycles of life, things like that. Going into the Mother Earth, where we came from, where we will go back. Everything in there is symbolic to being connected with the earth. Just as the names of our villages, for instance, of San Geronimo Valley, Chautauqua, we refer to what might have been the abundance in the area. Things like that, we would reference to things so we know where certain areas are. For instance, I saw a comment already. I don't want to jump the gun here, but we did make a reference to some names. We referred to the San Rafael area as Awan Iwish. And we believe that that means the red earth basket people. That's because of the red ochre and the types of basket materials that come from the area. So these are just some things, how we were connected with the land. You know, it wasn't just naming something. It was naming something for a specific purpose. Like Dean said, we always have purpose in what we're doing. So these names are very, very powerful when you think of it in that way. Back to names. Tom Smith, so he was Junior. His father was Thomas Comshetal. So Tom Smith's name was Thomas Comshetal. Tom Smith's birth name is Lily Leka. Lily Leka means to be hanging in the air. Horizontally, like this, hanging in the air. That's his real name. So thank you, Nancy, for the wonderful introduction and the land acknowledgement and the history that you gave on Tom Smith. And to furthermore on that, you see the change that Tom Smith had to go through, being born with a native name, then being given the name Thomas Comshetal, then be given the name Thomas Smith. I can't imagine if, you know, one of us going through, you know, that right now today, if, you know, we had to constantly change our name and our identity. I think about that a lot. Anyways. Yes, I am Coast Miwok and we are still here. And I'm very proud to be here. And I thank you all for this opportunity to be able to speak. I'm not really sure just what to speak of off the top of my mind, but I'm more than happy to ask and answer any questions that anybody has. So thank you.
Oh.
Can I, I wrote, can I share something?
Please.
So I am, there's so much to talk about when you talk about like, what can I share in a few minutes to express a whole culture that maybe for a lot of people is completely alien. But I'd like to come to something we can understand, and that's baskets. So our people were known for wonderful baskets. This is a traditional styled winnowing basket. So it's sort of for winnowing, the knocking the chaff off of what sometimes might be pine nuts or other things that we might be using, and also for beating seeds. Because there are many things that we ate, for example, was the wild grains that was out in the field. There's so many wild grasses that we ate. And the Spaniards called, we made a kind of a bread, and the Spaniards called it pinole, but it was a mixed grain, and it was kind of a bread. We made that, also milled that and used it. Also, we had a lot of tubers that we're eating as well. So we would gather up different types of potatoes, the bredea, the little corms, corms are called, and very nutritious. Also, we're well known for our, eating our acorns and gathering acorns from the oak trees. And that's why we would have an oak tree. And an oak tree might be in a family, it lives for hundreds of years, and it would be passed down from generation to generation. And a family would have somewhat of a ownership and take care of that tree. And so Satako, there that Sandra with the live oak, those trees were treasured, beautiful, wonderful, some of the best acorns for eating off the coast, live oak. And so that was a premium location. And so just kind of behind me, you can see I've got a tule boat sitting in the corner, and Dean Hoagland has a Curtis photograph of one behind him, and you see that tule boat. It's made out of tule grass, and this is one of our conveyances. It's like a big basket. We're crazy for baskets. I like to think that we were beyond the Stone Age. We were in the basket age. We did everything with baskets. We cooked in baskets. Baskets woven so tightly they'd hold hot water, hot boiling water. And we cook our acorn soup in hot boiling water in a basket with the hot rocks. So we had many, many things that could be done with baskets. So that reminds me of this, of a little story about Oye Oyish, Old Man Coyote. So when we talk about, part of our culture is the stories of the first people. And the first people are not Indians. The first people are Oye Oyish, Old Man Coyote, Choyeki the deer, Cooley the bear, Kokalish the raven, Seish the blue jay. So many great characters, and those were the first people that came before man. And in that time, the first people had weren't solid form in their form, right? They had human qualities, they had magical powers, they could fly. But then when man was created, things kind of crystallized and kind of got boring. So our first people's stories might inadvertently result in the creation of man, but they weren't really about man. He wasn't that interesting. The first people were interesting. So this one of the stories I like to tell is about Oye Oyish when he was staring up at the night sky, and he was looking up there and he saw them little hetees, those little stars, and he was looking and he was wondering what they were. Well, we're basket people. And so we know that if you take a basket and you hold it up to the light, even really tight baskets got tiny little holes. When you hold it up to the sun, those tiny little holes, those tiny little pokes of light come through the basket, and he realized what he was seeing. He was looking at the bottom of the basket of the universe that was woven by Hama Haichala, grandmother spider, of course. And that could only mean one thing, that the sky people were up there on the other side of the basket of the universe, hoarding all the Chewa and the Wookiee, all the light and the fire. Oh, he says, well, I need to go up there, get some of that fire and bring it down here. But then he was looking up there and he noticed how them little hitis, they kind of open and close, you call it a twinkle. Well, he knew what that meant, because see, we're basket people, and the beauty of a basket is it's flexible, can carry a big burden and sway, and not it's not brittle, it's not gonna break. It's flexible under the weight. And he realized that the great basket of the universe was flexing under the all the stuff that was in it. And so that was causing these little tiny hiti holes to open and close a little bit and give us that twinkle. Well, he realized that if he wasn't fast enough, he tried to go through that basket of the universe, he could get caught in the weef and the weft of the basket and be caught forever in the basket of the universe. He said, oh, that wouldn't do for Oyeoish. But now his friend Kalupi, the hummingbird, she is very fast. So he called Kalupi. He said, Kalupi, come help me. He says, the sky people are up there hoarding all the Chewa and the Wookiee on the other side of the basket of the universe. If you could fly to that Hiti hole and get some of that Chewa and that Wookiee and bring it down, we could have light and fire here. So Kalupi says, okay, I will try. So she flies off. He didn't even warn her about getting caught in the basket. She flies off, goes through a Hiti hole, and just as Oyeoish had predicted, all this Chewa and all this Wookiee, all this fire and light. Oh, she's so excited. She starts gathering up the fire and light under her arm. And she starts carrying. She says, I'm going to carry this fire and light back down to the people. She goes back to the Hiti hole. And right before she gets out, a sky person said, hey, look, Kalupi's trying to steal the fire. Let's get her. And somebody threw a lightning bolt and it split her tail. And she goes, woohoo, and leaps through that Hiti hole, carrying as much Wookiee and Chewa as she can. She comes burning down out of the sky like this, coming burning down. And as she's coming down, well, all the other people start gathering around. There's Oyeoish is there holding an abalone shell. And then Kuli the bear is there, and Choyeki the deer, and Kokolish the raven is there. And they're all gathered around. And then when by the time Kalupi gets to the bottom, all she has left is a little is an ember tucked underneath her chin like this. She'd carried all the way down this one little ember underneath her chin. And that's why Kalupi has that red throat still today from carrying that burning ember down from the sky people. Well, Eric, now she drops this little burning ember into the abalone shell, and all the people stare in wide-eyed wonder and look at this burning ember. And then Oyeoish gets all excited and he reaches down and grabs that ember and he goes, woohoo! Well, of course it's hot. And he goes, woo, wee, ah, and tosses it from hand to hand. Sparks are flying. He starts hooting. They said, be careful, Oye, be careful. You're ruining it. And he goes hooting and holler over the hill. And they chase after him. By the time they get to him, the ember is all gone. And they say, Oyeoish, you ruined it. Here, Kalupi risked her life to go get this Chewa from the sky people. And you just spoiled it. And then they walk off, but actually they walk off kind of quickly, because as he was running, they saw the sparks flying, and some sparks landed in the buckeye tree, and some sparks landed in the mule fat, and some landed in the elderberry, and some landed in the cattail, and some landed in the cedar. Not everybody knows all the places where the sparks went, but what we do know is if you can get two of those plant people who ate those sparks, and you rub them together, you can get that fire back out. And that's how we still make our fire with our hand drill, using bringing those two things together to bring that fire out. Ho! Do I hear an O?
Oh.
If you're out there in TV land, thank you for owing me and for hearing my whole song, my story. I'm gonna have story. I have to tell you a little song, and this is a song called the Wookiee Yomi song. Wookiee is fire and Yomi is home. Now Wookiee Yomi is our word for our sweat lodge, our California style sweat lodge, which is like a mini roundhouse. And then we didn't use hot rocks. We had a small fire inside. And so we go in and that's how we sweat in our ways. So I like to. So this is also a home that that you might keep a sacred fire somewhere in your home, where you might have a fireplace, or you may have a sacred fire, and you can use this song for this sacred fires. And it's also, I like to think of it as a song for a place that you're keeping your fire. And like, for example, this group that you're in, and when you come together monthly or bi-monthly, I'm not sure how often you come together, you rekindle that fire and talk about the issues that are important to you. So this committee that you're on here is in a way like your own sacred fire. So I offer this song to you guys as well. It goes like this. Wookie-o, me wookie-o, me wookie-o, me wookie-o. Wookie-o, me wookie-o, me wookie-o, me wookie-o. Wookie-o, me wookie-o, wookie-o, me wookie-o. Wookie-o, me wookie-o, me wookie-o, me wookie-o. Wookie-o, me wookie-o, me wookie-o, me wookie-o. Wookie-o, me wookie-o, me wookie-o, me wookie-o. Wookie-o, me wookie-o, wookie-o, me wookie-o. Wookie-o, me wookie-o, me wookie-o, me wookie-o. Wookie-o, me wookie-o, me wookie-o, me wookie-o. Wookie-o, me wookie-o, me wookie-o, me wookie-o. Wookie-o, me wookie-o, wookie-o, me wookie-o. Wookie-o, me wookie-o, me wookie-o, me wookie-o. Wookie-o, me wookie-o, me wookie-o, me wookie-o. Wookie-o, me wookie-o, me wookie-o, me wookie-o. Wookie-o, me wookie-o, wookie-o, me wookie-o. Wookie-o, me wookie-o, me wookie-o, me wookie-o. Ho, 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 ho.
Oh. Oh.
All right, well, I'll pass the baton there. One of my cousins may want to say something. Ho.
Ho.
Where'd Jason go?
Okay, all right. I'm the young guy, so, you know, I'm always trying to let everybody else speak. Somebody mentioned something about plants and medicine. I've seen in the comments. Anybody ever seen this plant right here? See those leaves?
Mm-hmm.
See those leaves? Some people know this as wormwood, but it's not wormwood. This is called mugwort. In our language, I think we say kachina. This is our medicine. This is the most sacred plant to our people. After the great flood, you know, our people were doing bad, and Creator seeing that, you know, people were no good. We're doing bad things. He flooded the earth. There's a great flood. After the water started going down, the mountaintops started appearing. One of the mountaintops that appears is Tamal Paish, Tamalpais, some of you know it as. We say Paish, Tamal Paish, the big mountain by the bay. Once the mountain peaks started appearing, the birds were molting. And when the birds were molting, they dropped their feathers. And one of the great birds that dropped their feathers is the condor, the moloch. This is a basket, one of a very tight woven basket. You see this coil, that perfection. This wasn't done with a lay or a compass, or this is because the perfection of the stitching. The condor, Creator took the feathers of the molting birds and he took some mud. Long story short, the duck goes down to the bottom of the waters, pull up some mud, pull up some toolies, makes a blanket, puts some mud in the toolies, wraps it up, takes a feather, the condor and the different birds, and puts them all on the different mountaintops, wraps up the toolie, and coyote blows into the mud. And that's where the different people of all the mountaintops of all the different villages come from. And so this is a recently made basket. It's symbolic to the condor. This is an offering basket, tobacco basket for ceremony. Now I'm showing this because there was an ancient find in Larkspur. I think it was something like 7,000 years old or something like that. They found an ancient condor burial. But you can clearly see today that this is something that still exists in our people, in our culture. We still do these things that are thousands of years old. They haven't changed. Yet we never had any. We didn't have no computers. We didn't have no iPhones. We didn't have no calendars to keep track or nothing like that. But we knew when to do these ceremonies and how to keep them going. They haven't changed. And so just remember, when you're out in the woods, when you're out walking, when you see this wormwood, when you see this mugwort, or what we say, kachina, this was one of the first plants that popped up after the great flood that was given to our people to teach us how to heal. This plant can do many things right here. It could take the pain out of your body. You can eat the leaves. It's very bitter. You can make a tea out of it. But one thing that we do is we breathe the smoke of this. And we don't smoke it in a pipe or anything like that. What we do is, this plant in the right conditions can reach 12 feet tall, long straight stick all the way up. So we grab a bunch of sticks and we make a big bundle, like how, you know, most of you know how you make a sage bundle. Well, we didn't use white sage. We used this plant right here. So that's just something that I'd like to share. Also something that I have it in the kitchen, of course. But you have it all around you, is the bay tree. The bay tree is another one of our very sacred medicines. I drink it as a tea on a regular basis. I take a good handful of leaves, 15 to 20 leaves. I put it in a big pot of water and I rapid boil it. You got to rapid boil the bay leaves for a good 15 to 20 minutes. And then you can add your honey. I like to add cinnamon. But what it does is it keeps your immune system up. So we got two sacred plants right here that grow everywhere in California. You got bay leaf and you got the mugwort right here. So this is a pain reliever, the mugwort right here, for arthritis, for indigestion, your stomach issues and things like that. And also keep your immunity up. The bay leaf is very, very powerful, especially during this time of stress and being locked down and, you know, with this COVID thing flowing around right now. Bay leaf is a real powerful medicine that, you know, you can cook with it. You know, people put it in their spaghetti, but, you know, one or two leaves doesn't do much but give you flavor. You got to boil a pot of bay leaves and drink it. See how you like it.
Oh. Thank you, Jason. As Jason was saying, you know, with that, those bay leaves too, and it, like you said, it's good for your respiratory, for your lungs. It strengthens them, and, you know, builds up your immune system, like you said. So. We've been offering that, you know, to locally, you know, to a lot of our elders, you know, during this time. because they're, you know, again, because of the pandemic, you know, we want to do what we can in traditional way, offering those traditional medicines to help, you know, boost their immune systems. So I want to thank Jason for sharing that. And so just ask permission. So again, you know, we're just entering in this time, you know, we're ceremonial people, and we're getting ready to, you know, for our renewal ceremonies that are going to take place. It's known as the Strawberry Festival, you know, and so what we're doing is we're giving thanks for the new season, for the new fruits that the Creator blessed us with. And so we'll be having, you know, we'll be having those ceremonies, you know, and that was one of my intentions when I went to, you know, Kulilokwe yesterday, just to check the grounds, you know, and see, you know, what the possibility was, you know, for us to have something, if not there somewhere, maybe it's going to be in over in San Geronimo Valley. So we'll keep you posted, you know, and so before we go any further, I just want to offer a song. And again, you know, this past year has been a really challenging time, especially for us, you know, and not being able to have our ceremonies, you know. So, you know, we just ask, you know, this song, just in the ask Creator for, again, just to have, you know, have compassion, have pity on us, you know. Sometimes we are those pitiful human beings, you know. So I'll offer this song in a good way. That song is our forgiveness song. And so that song was, I always want to acknowledge my relative, Lanny Panola, you know, that, you know, shared that song with us always. And, you know, and, you know, just, you know, I see Lanny, you know, and, you know, when I hear that song, you know, when I offer that, you know, and because he blessed us, he blessed my life, you know, as being a beautiful relative. And, you know, again, he encouraged me, you know, to carry on these cultural ways. And it's because of him, you know, we still And we do that, you know, like even though we didn't have it last year, when we have our grandmother's dance, you know, the Maria Copa honor dance, and which, you know, again, I appreciate, you know, cousin Jason and cousin Sky, you know, being a part of that, you know, and we have good memories, you know, even though our roundhouse was has been recently, you know, down and, you know, unfortunately been desecrated, but still we have good memories of, you know, ceremony there, you know, and, you know, sleeping in the roundhouse, you know, and, you know, just sleeping with our prayers, sleeping with our ancestors. And so, and again, that song, you know, again, was for not only us, you know, but all, for each one of you. So again, thank you for the opportunity. Oh.
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 Thank you. Thank you all for all of your sharing, all of your wisdom and your gifts. There's a couple of questions that I wanted to ask any one of you to answer. One is a past and one is a future. And so perhaps the past one I could give to Jason, because he's the one who introduced me to this. And I'm sure others would love to know what you shared when we were out on the commons in San Geronimo in October, and you walked around the property and you pointed out some things on the big rock there and some ideas, some sense of how the people might have moved across the land and been with the animals and the fish. And I wondered if you could share a little bit of what you saw in the land there.
Oh, okay. I don't know what you're talking about, Nancy. That was a secret we were supposed to keep. We weren't supposed to share any of that. No, I'm just kidding. I think it needs to be noted that San Geronimo Valley currently has an archaeology site being observed at the moment. With that being said, it is identified as a cultural place, without a doubt. Regardless of my opinion, it has already been noted. Now, when we were down there around that big rock, I noticed some burn marks on the rocks there. You would build a fire up against a rock for a reflection of heat, of course, to stay warm. A rock is also a barrier. It's also a blind. That valley of the boulevard there going through is a migration trail of what we can imagine big tule elk, mule deer, antelope. You know, we tend to think of just deer and things like that today, but you know, there was antelope and tule elk. You know, we recognize that the tule elk were there. We're starting to see that, and we're starting to do things to preserve that, but there was also antelope running through California, all through the foothills. So it's not a place where we would want to disturb the migration and keep the food from coming in. So I don't see us nesting down, so to speak, on the creek there. That's our kitchen area, our gathering place. Might have gathered a lot of medicines that you just can't see today because, you know, it's been dried up. You know, the redwoods have been cut down. It's not just the redwoods, it's everything underneath the redwoods. From the smaller trees all the way to the bushes, to the ferns, to the mosses, all the way down to the lichens on the rock. you know, it's a whole ecosystem that has been disturbed that you just, it's hard to see what was there until you make a turn on the Nicasio Boulevard and you start to go over the hill and you come down and you see that new housing development in there with those big giant $1 million homes. I see a lot of spring water coming through that area. I see an area that has been disturbed and filled in where the marshland no longer is allowed to be, and things like tules would grow. And with that kind of environment, you would have a lot of fowl, a lot of birds, a lot of different things going on when you start picturing that. And I just see an abundance of food and giant oak trees, giant redwoods, and also burned hilltops. If you're in that area, you see a lot of rounded mound type areas. You know, there was a lot of water. One way to stay dry is to stay up high. So a lot of archaeologists, a lot of people would like to think that we built our houses down in the bottom, right next to the creek where we could easily grab it. But it wasn't like that for us. To hop over a mountain a mile or two was nothing for us. Also, to be tucked away in that little valley back there, you're tucked away, you're protected. The reason I'm bringing this up is because I think development needs to stop back there. There was not a proper observation. You know, here's the, I do a lot of TIPO work with other Miwok people outside of Marin County. Right now I live in Tuolumne County and I am a cultural monitor for the Chicken Ranch Band of Miwok. And this is something that we come across a lot with archaeology. Well, the site's already been surveyed. The ship already came through. The archaeologist already came through and he hasn't seen anything. Yeah, until you let us out there, then we start pointing everything out. You know, it's all, it's like I said, Grayton is currently the MLD doing the work out there in San Geronimo Valley right now on the creek. They have their TIPO out there, which works with the SHPO, with the state. So I just wanted to make that, you know, be known since Nancy asked, that it is identified as a cultural site at the moment. Regardless of my opinions or what I think is there, it has already been identified. So.
Thank you, Jason. And there is a magic in the land too. And I think that's the other piece that Jason is alluding to. All the stories of the land and the stories that are held in the land. And perhaps when we're through with this whole COVID situation, we could at some point sponsor a walk and an opportunity to see the land through Native eyes and to learn more and to gain some wisdom of what is really there. It is really there. What I'd also like to do very briefly is just ask, throw it open to the council, and perhaps this is Dean, or perhaps this is Sky, or what are some plans for the future? Where does the council, what are you looking at in terms of visioning going forward?
I don't know if anybody else wants to answer, but I'll take that on just briefly. And again, like I shared from the beginning, this is a vision of ours. You know, that, and then in relationship to the land, you know, the land is calling us back. We have a sacred obligation and responsibility as the original stewards and caretakers of the land. And so that's why I'm really pleased that this group, when you talk about, you know, what your intentions are, what your work is around, you know, environmental, not only stewardship, restoration, right? Because as we know, and like what Cousin Jason just shared, everything's out of balance. And not just here, but, you know, throughout Turtle Island, throughout the world. You know, and it should always be about, you know, about the land, about, that's our mother. We have to have that relationship. And so I see our vision, and we've identified our priorities. And of course, land, you know, stewardship is one of them. Having that relationship in place. Of course, with y'all's support, right? Yeah. And walking forward with us, right? Because we can't do it alone, you know? And I think, you know, again, cultural, again, restoration, a language, revitalization. Those are the things. And so how do we do this? You know, we came up with this idea of a living cultural center. We need our own sacred land, a sacred, you know, place to have ceremonies where we don't have to rely on the federal government. Hence, you know, Point Reyes National Seashore. And it just makes so much sense. And I don't know if anybody else wants to chime in. You know, there was a question, and again, I just want to answer it real quickly about a prophecy. I don't know about a prophecy and why things happen, why, you know, the invaders came in and, you know, we experienced this historical trauma and we've recovered because we have historical trauma, but we have historical resilience. And that's why I'm a proud Coast Miwok Native man today. But I think what that experience really has tested us to, you know, show who we are as humans, as good human beings, right? And so that's my answer to that. So I don't know if anybody else wants to chime in as far as, you know, moving forward. Thank you, Nancy.
I just want to add one quick little point and it also kind of answers one of the questions in here. It says, what are your thoughts on this sudden oak death? Well, you know, that's one of those things that has, you know, popped up and you wonder what to do. I got this tip from this elder. She says, oh, I know exactly what's going on with that. You ain't loving your trees anymore. You're not doing your ceremonies. See, in the old days, we would have acorn festival. And we still do these a certain ceremony, and we'll do a dance around the oak tree. And in the ceremony, the girls, they carry a stick, and as they walk around the tree, they tap the oak tree with this stick as they walk around it. And it's kind of done in this dance, so it's kind of ceremonial. But this is a demonstration of what we're supposed to do when we go out and gather the acorns, is you tap it with the limbs and everything to knock the acorns off. But this also acts as a massage. It stimulates the tree, this tapping on there, and also the singing to this tree, because these oak trees aren't wild. If you can imagine, these are domesticated plants. These are domesticated oak trees, and they've been in, you know, for thousands of years cultivated, kind of like a house cat or a chicken, you know, like they're made to be with people, you know, and now, I mean, they can go live out wild, but they're not, the oak tree is not a wild plant. It's a domesticated, it's been domesticated. And we planted the oaks, and we had medicines. We knew everything there was to know about oak trees. We would plant them, tend them, take care of them, and did special ceremonies for them. So anyway, just to say that is to segue when you ask about the future, is to bring back some of those traditional practices that were part of the ancient way. There's no reason we're not gathering those acorns every year, doing them in a good way, and then processing and eating that acorn flour. That acorn soup is highly nutritious. It's great for diabetics, and it's a whole food source. And remembering that the way with that. Oh, and then someone else had mentioned about the buckeye. The buckeye is also, we eat that as well. But the bay nuts. Jason had talked about the bay leaves, but also we eat the bay nuts, and that was roasted. They is another nutrition, and we have songs and ceremonies for the bay as well. So anyway, just to bring that back in.
Mm-hmm. Oh, thank you, Sky. So we're getting close to when we need to wrap it up here, but I just want to say you can tell just from this short time tonight that there is a wealth of information, knowledge, traditional ways, pathways for the future that the Tribal Council has. And if any of you would like to stay in touch, would like updates, would like to know more, you can visit their website, which will be a constantly growing website because it's brand new. So it will be having things added to it. So we encourage you to come back regularly to look, as well as to join the email list. And that's www.coastmiwokofmarin.org. And I will see if I can maybe put it up into the chat, but it's very coastmiwokofmarin.org, and you can join the email list and learn more about what they are doing and ways in the future that you may be able to become involved to help, to support, as Dean said, because it's not just the five, they are the center pole. They're the ones that are holding the medicine, but it is going to take a village of support to help to realize this dream and to bring the wisdom that's in the land and that's been sleeping in the land all of these many thousands of years, to bring it out, bring it current. And certainly we all need it. We all need it. So I want to thank you all. I want to turn it back over to Brian now. And I thank all of you council members, Dean and Jason, Steve, Joe, Sky, so much for what you've shared with us. Thank you.
Thank you, Nancy. That was incredible. At this point, all I can say is that was one of the most moving pieces of presentation I think I've ever seen. The history, the medicine, the stories, and the songs were almost overwhelming in their beauty and their moving power. And it was a real honor. At this point, I have to do our basic plug for the planning group and say, for those of you who aren't members, we would love your membership. We're a small environmental nonprofit who work as hard as we can with volunteers to make our place better, to protect our environment, and to keep the character of our little community as intact as possible. thanks to the 100 people that we had stay with us through the entire presentation. Very impressive. But of course, the subject matter was so entertaining and so interesting, and as I said, overwhelming. That I mean, far more interesting than anything you could possibly catch on Netflix for sure. I hope we have an opportunity to do this again in the future as the Miwok Council of Marin evolves, as they gain federal recognition and state recognition. And it's, I should say outright, that there's no question that we want to be there for you guys, that we want to provide as much support as we possibly can in any way possible. And Nancy, if it's all right with you, will be our liaison. I'm sure you'll be, she'll be helping you out. I know she's been working hard on your new website. So that's really fantastic. Thanks to the 100 people who attended. Thanks to the steering committee for their tireless work, and thanks to our featured guests. Probably the single best presentation we've ever had in our 50-year history.
Thank you.
Real honor. Any last comments from the council before we wrap up?
Just thank you.
Yes, thank you very much. We really appreciate this. We love the area.
In our language.
We love the San Geronimo Valley.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Kamuli, thank you.
Good to see you, Biddy Gert.
Yeah.
Brother Eric. Everyone, thank you.
John thank Littleton, you, nice to see you.
John, yes.
Thanks for the books.
Jane, we'll see you, Jane. Blessings.
Blessings, thank you.
Oh.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. So we'll be closing up, but the video, Miwok Council was kind enough to allow us to videotape their presentation. We will be notifying folks where that can be found once we do a quick review and make sure, you know, it's edited and have everybody's name spelled correctly who gave the presentation, and we'll make that available. And we're also gonna provide on our website links to the new Miwok Council website, so that we'll help folks find that. And we're always available for any additional information or contacts if folks are interested in knowing more about the council and knowing more about how you can help.